And welcome to another episode of History Now. On today's show, we're going to be talking about the latest History Ireland special publication on the treaty split, but it also looks at the partition of Ireland. So joining me today is one of the co-editors of this. He's an Associate Professor of Irish Studies in UCD, formerly of Queen's University Belfast, Dr. Darragh Gannon. So Darragh, you're very welcome to the show. I'm delighted to have you on to talk about this really, really fantastic book.
Thank you so much, Barry. Thanks for the invitation. It's great to be with you.
Yeah, of course, Darragh, the centenary publication, The Split, the new History of Ireland, it's the fourth in the series. This is what you're here to talk about today. Can you give us a bit of background on that? Because I know you co-edited that with Tommy Graham and Brian Hanley, who have both been on the show before. So could you give us a wee bit of background about how this one came about?
So this, as you said, is the fourth special issue or supplement of History Ireland's Decade of Centenaries programme. The first was All Change Changed Utterly, looking at the period after the 1916 Rising. And this special issue, which I have, of course, with me, never lose a genuine opportunity to market this, is entitled The Split. And that pertains not only to the Irish Civil War, but, of course, the issue of partition itself. And we were delighted, of course, that we had so many worthy scholars contributing essays to this particular centenary supplement, and none more so than President of Ireland, Michael D. Higgins.
Yes, Darragh, and that is another thing I wanted to talk about, was President Higgins' contribution to the publication. Because, and I've had some discussions with a couple of different historians, I think overall he has been to the forefront of this commemoration period. And it's a very difficult thing to do, but I think by and large he's approached it well with a great deal of knowledge and diplomacy. But what he's also done is he has globalised it, like yourself, like Fergal McGarry and other people have put it in a global context. Could you tell us a bit about that?
Well, that's right. As you mentioned, we were honoured to be invited to Oras Eleuteron by President Higgins in recognition of the issue of this very special supplement on the Civil War. And President Higgins was a delightful host. He welcomed us very warmly. We discussed issues from commemoration to current issues in Irish society. And as you know, he's not only a scholar, but he's an intellectual of the very highest calibre. So he could range quite widely from history to philosophy over the course of coffee and scones. So that was quite a nice afternoon and a recognition of all the hard work put in to make this special issue a success. President Higgins' introduction was entitled The Split, From Truce to Treaty to Civil War 1921 to 1923. And he quite rightly references broader work in terms of the decade of commemorations, especially his Machnov 100 series, that public series of seminars which seeks to deliberate really on the issues of the events of 100 years ago in a very open way and allowing for different traditions, different interpretations, contested memories. And President Higgins, of course, has characterized this kind of generosity as ethical remembering. Hospitality of narratives is the term which he uses quite frequently to characterise his interventions in these commemorative debates. And really his piece for the History of Ireland special issue is an extension of that Machnov 100 series, insofar as he is acknowledging the differing perspectives on those events 100 years ago. And he's really arguing for, two things. First of all, he's arguing for a recognition of the pain and emotional distress caused by the events of 100 years ago, which have informed not only those events, but also in a legacy sense, the political cultures in which we live on this island, north and south, in the 100 years since. So I think he's arguing for almost a moment of acknowledgement that these were distressing events, divisive, and we need to, in order to heal moving forward, his article states, we need to recognise the emotional distress which they cause rather than papering over the cracks. And secondly, I think his key intervention in his essay is in relation to looking at power inequalities. Specifically the issue of empire, and he makes a key point that power, specifically the issue of violence, was derived primarily from imperial frameworks. So the British state, in its interventions on the island of Ireland, used violence to effect political change, and Republicans and Unionists followed, President Higgins argues, that template set by the imperial state, as he put it, in the context of Irish nationalism and Irish unionism, respectively. And furthermore, he argues that the Irish divisions which characterised the Civil War and partition were part of a broader international milieu within which empires and aspiring nation states competed for territory and for the right to claim their political status and authority. So it's a wide-ranging piece and very much an extension of his broader interventions, key interventions in this decade of centenaries.
That's a really important point. You know, the empire, not just the British Empire, but we're talking, you know, we're coming to the end of the age of empires in this particular period. So there's other empires at play. But I really want to just focus in on you for a second, because you've been really to the forefront of this global Irish Revolution research over the last number of years. So can I ask you, how important is it to you personally that you do internationalise this and contextualise it with what's going on elsewhere in the world at this point?
I think it's vitally important because, I mean, first of all, in terms of education, I think the global aspects of the Irish Revolution is in many ways a new narrative for a lot of people, especially the readership of History Ireland, who aren't necessarily, you know, based at universities and so on, that this is something that we're bringing to the table for the first time in this particular period. I think it's important as well to put in context and to give proportion to the events that transpired in Ireland. You can look, for example, at the events of Bloody Sunday and Amritsar in comparative context, and the numbers who were killed by British forces, by British military forces in India, far exceeded those who were killed in Dublin in November of 1920. Now, that is not to give moral greater moral weight to one event or the other, but it is to better understand and comprehend how the powers of the imperial state worked. And one of the key, I think, suggestions that derives from that very brief comparative analysis is that, you know, issues of race informed British policy in Ireland. So Ireland, despite the fact that it was part of the United Kingdom and was seen to be part of the imperial project, was nonetheless a white nation. Whereas obviously in India, the British state exercised greater military power and did not have the restraint that they would have towards white nations. So we need to look at the issue of Irish nationalism and the Irish Revolution in comparative context. And the final point I would make in terms of how important it is that the global context finally integrates the Irish diaspora into the story of Ireland. Enda Delaney has characterised the Irish history books up until the recent period as an island story. And I think it's very important that we integrate the experiences of Irish Americans, the Irish in Australia, but also places further afield. And this is brought out in my own essay in South America, in Europe, and further afield again into this narrative, because the Irish Revolution was not just about ambushes in County Cork, however important they may have been. It was also about political change, popular mobilisation, and propaganda, which very much characterised the Irish Revolution globally.
Darragh, can we now talk about some of the contributors? And I want to go back and look at a couple of them in particular in detail, but there's a whole range of contributors to this and to the previous special editions. How do you go about, you know, choosing who goes in? Do you send out a call for papers, or do you have certain people in mind, or what's the process? Because there's so many different areas of research around this revolutionary period that are taking place. It's perhaps hard to, you know, hone in on different people.
It kind of varies. So this issue, quite literally, was broached by the senior editor of History Ireland, Tommy Graham, to myself and Brian Hanley, as far away ago as a year ago, so the winter of 2020. And again, the idea was to try and, in many ways, envisage what the commemorative mood or atmosphere would have been like when the publication emerged. And we were just very conscious, Brian Hanley and I, especially both as practicing historians working in the field of the Irish Revolution, about the latest scholarship. So we tried to kind of bring forth the latest scholarship, either scholars or the actual works themselves, which would bring out new ideas and revise perhaps established orthodoxies, to try and show the general public, you know, the development of ideas over the course of this decade of centenary. So we really have a mixture of very established scholars such as Robert Gravarth and Charles Townsend, who've written extensively on this period before, and very successfully with younger scholars such as Alison Martin. We also have Caitlin White, so PhD students and MA students, and we felt it was very important to give them as well a platform to demonstrate their research. So I think that was really important to find a balance, and of course gender balance is important as well. What's also really interesting is that through this Global Irish Revolution project that I've been working on, publications that I've worked on, we've really tried to find a balance between Ireland and diaspora scholars as well. Because very often scholars who are working in Ireland, in Australia, in the United States, etc., get left out of these kind of publications because they're just not on the spot in Dublin or Belfast. So we really tried to restore the balance there by bringing in scholars such as Bill Cassan, who's based in London, Elizabeth Malcolm in Melbourne, and so on and so forth.
Absolutely, and as I say, you know, there's so many areas of academic research around this particular period of our history. It is fascinating, but if I can again just go back to your contribution to it, apart from, of course, co-editing it, but your article in the publication on the Irish Race Congress. Now, I don't think there's too many people would probably be familiar with what the Irish Race Congress was and what its function was. Can you give us a bit of background on your article?
So the Irish Race Congress, to me, is a fascinating episode in this period of Irish history, one of the lost histories of the period in many ways, because the signing of the Anglo-Irish Treaty and subsequent Irish Civil War basically cast a shadow over the events in Paris. But essentially, it was a seven-day congress which was intended to gather together the representatives of Irish nationalism all over the world who had been working in separate nationalist movements for the 3 years prior to that. Now, the Congress begins on the 21st of January 1922, and this is organized on purpose because it's seen to represent the 3 years since the formation of Dáil Éireann on the 21st of January 1919 in Dublin. Now, it's quite interesting because the Congress has gone down in the history books insofar as it has been recorded at all as basically an extension of the Dáil Treaty debates. So basically a proto-civil war in discussion form. But I would argue in this article that actually that's to, undermine the significance of the Race Congress as it actually was envisaged. Because the Race Congress was created ostensibly by diaspora organisers, not the Dáil deputies who subsequently defined its event. So it was suggested in March of 1921 by the Irish Republican Association of South Africa that a Race Congress could be interesting as a means of intervening in the then military stalemate between Republican forces and British Crown forces during the War of Independence. And it was envisaged that this would be a counterweight to the global impact and force of the British Empire, which we mentioned earlier. And through contact with Art O'Brien, the London Irish Nationalist, they set about organising this event. And this went on until the summer of 1921 during the truce period, when Eamon de Valera and the Department of Foreign Affairs basically co-opted this Irish Race Congress and sought to organise it from Dublin, led by Catherine Hughes, one of de Valera's trusted lieutenants, who was a Canadian-born nationalist, but who de Valera worked with quite extensively during the revolution. And ultimately, between the 21st of January and 28th of January 1922, over 100 delegates from 22 countries, including Ireland, would sit in Paris in what I characterise in this article as the second Anglo-Irish treaty debates. And they debate everything from the treaty itself to issues of race, nationality, citizenship, and the future of the Irish diaspora.
Yeah, Darragh, it is a really fascinating idea to bring the diaspora together like that. And I suppose, you know, because it happens between the treaty vote and the Civil War, it's still a very sort of strange and muddled time in looking back. But what's really interesting that comes across really well in your article is there's like almost the dual identity of the people who are present. You have their Irish identity, but you also have their identity of their place of birth or residence in the diaspora, like the likes of Australia or America. There seems to be a bit of a conflicting idea of Irishness, you know, Irish American or Irish Australian. What does that tell us about identity in this context?
I think you raised an interesting point in relation to identity. Whereas the treaty debates themselves were characterized by debate over constitutional issues and the oath of allegiance, you know, the technical aspects of the Anglo-Irish Treaty, the debates in Paris less than a month later were characterized by debates about identity and what it meant to be Irish and who decided, you know, who was Irish. So issues of citizenship, really, before their time. And what was quite interesting is that the term the Irish race has been used quite widely during this period. In fact, the idea of an Irish race convention was used quite widely during this period. In other writings which I've published and which are due to be published, I've talked about the invention of the Irish race convention. And this is the idea that Irish nationalists around the world used that term, an Irish race convention, in its singularity to affect power all over the world. So we have Irish race conventions in Philadelphia, in February of 1919, and we have a race convention in Melbourne in 1919, in Buenos Aires in 1921. And by the use of that term, Irish race convention, it suggests a uniformity of ideas and of identities. However, this is unraveled when they actually do all meet together in the Irish Race Congress in January of 1922. And what's quite interesting is that the Irish delegates from overseas advise people like Eamon de Valera and Owen McNeill, who were there as the Irish representatives, among others, that they have to tell them about their experiences in places like Australia, South Africa, and elsewhere. And the fact that their experiences of being Irish is very distinct from those in Ireland itself. One of the most interesting interventions is that of the South African delegate, who says that I am here as a citizen of South Africa first and an Irish nationalist second. So there are interesting dilemmas set out in these debates, not necessarily over the treaty itself, but over issues of identity which transcend the treaty debates and indeed the Civil War.
As you've clearly outlined, the theme of the publication is the split, but not only the treaty split, but the split of Ireland itself in partition. With regard to the Irish Race Congress, is there any sense that partition features in any of the debates that are in and around the Irish Race Congress?
It's interesting you mention that because, of course, Michael Laffin, who analysed the Anglo-Irish treaty debates in a quantitative manner, noted how few references were made to partition during the treaty debates in Dublin. And I'd say that fewer still references were made to partition in the Irish Race Congress itself. And I think that's part of the mischaracterization, really, of the Congress by historians who have addressed it from an Irish perspective, because they are looking for references to, you know, sovereignty, the Republic, partition, the Oath of Allegiance. But the issues range far wider during the Race Congress, to issues of Irish race, Irish citizenship, even things like education. How can we educate Irish people abroad going forward? One of the interesting aspects about this is that people like De Valera are suggesting things like a dictionary of Irish biography well before its time, talking about the need to establish chairs of Irish history or Irish studies around the world. So there's practical steps which are being urged by Irish diaspora members specifically to link them to the Irish race at home, as they would put it. And this is really a global debate rather than the national debate that transpires in Dublin.
What happens with, you know, the Irish Race Congress as you leave the Irish Revolutionary period and go into, you know, states of semi-normality? I don't think it could be called normality. But is there any sense of keeping this idea or this event going?
Well, again, I think this is one of the great lost moments in terms of the Irish Revolution. And I think it should be characterized in that sense of loss, much as the way as President Michael D. Higgins has talked about loss and acknowledging the kind of missed opportunities of 100 years ago. I think we have to characterize the Race Congress as one of those missed opportunities. Ostensibly, they set up an organization called, ironically, Fine Gael, and that is the family of the Gael. And the idea is that there will be a worldwide organization entitled Fine Gael, and that it will meet every 4 years as a Congress and deliberate over issues of global Irish concern. And this is ostensibly set up under the Free State, but it soon drifts because of the Free State's preoccupation with the Civil War and the early years of setting up that new entity. It also doesn't have the political purchase that it would ordinarily have because of those divisions, not only in Ireland, but around the world. So there's a lack of consensus in Paris in January of 1922 about what the future of the global Irish diaspora should be. The Fine Gael organization is dominated by English-speaking representatives, primarily in America and Great Britain, and there's a great outcry by representatives from Brazil, from France, from Chile, and South Africa, for instance, in Paris, that they are not being allowed onto the organizing body. And I've noted this in my conclusion, but I think it's one of the great ironies of the Irish Race Congress that this organization, Fine Gael, has been lost in the history books, whereas Fine Gael, the pro-treaty party, which was the successor to Cumann na Gael, is written about so extensively by Irish historians. And I think that's probably emblematic of the diaspora's position in Irish historiography, really.
Looking a bit again at partition, Darragh, it's an important theme that's addressed in the publication. Margaret O'Callaghan from Queen's has a piece on partition. Can you tell us what the general argument is in her article?
Yeah, we're particularly delighted to see Ciarán contribute this article because, as you said, this is an issue which resonates right up until the present day. And there are, of course, you know, pre-echoes of the later troubles in terms of the kind of violence which ensued, especially in Belfast during this period. And Ciarán's done a tremendous job of kind of attending to the fine detail of those killings in Belfast in March of 1922. And really what Ciarán does is he kind of goes on he tries to set the murders or the killings in real time. So one of his key references is the fact that 2A specials were killed on May Street in Belfast on the afternoon of the 23rd of March 1922, and then later that night into the early hours of the 24th we have the killings of the McMahons themselves. So he basically draws a straight line between the killings of the specials earlier that day to the killings of the McMahons themselves. And he kind of recreates in quite gruesome detail the actual episode as was recounted by eyewitnesses from the event itself. So as we know, Owen McMahon was mortally wounded when people who had heavy Belfast accents and were wearing police uniforms broke into their family home using a sledgehammer. His sons, Patrick, Frank, Thomas, were killed as part of the attack. And a friend, Edward McKinney, was also killed. Two other sons, Bernard and John, were injured, severely injured. And indeed, Bernard would later die on the 2nd of April, accounting for their wounds. And really, kind of most poignantly of all, their youngest son, the 11-year-old Michael McMahon, survived by rolling under a couch and feigning death. Now, these events, of course, could be contextualized by the ongoing violence in Belfast specifically. And I think Ciarán mentions this, it's important to register this with our viewers, that Belfast really is a separate story to the wider Irish Revolution. It has its own timeline, it has its own local context. Acts of violence were often committed in response to local acts of violence. Just to give you a sense of how intense the violence is during this period, in February 1922, 48 people were killed in Belfast alone, and this marks the high point of deaths accruing to violence since the outbreak of violence in Northern Ireland in July of 1920. So it's remarkable, as you said in your question, how the McMahon murders, in spite of the widespread violence during this period in Belfast, still resonates to this day. And even someone like Winston Churchill, who was judged by many contemporaries not to be a friend of Irish nationalism, said that they had to search all over Europe to find instances of an equal atrocity. I think that speaks to the visceral nature of these killings in Belfast.
I think it bears mentioning that Ciarán's article, because it's one of these incidents that really resonates, you know, today, perhaps because of, you know, more recent conflict, that it's really detailed, but he really takes great care in telling the story, and it really emphasises just how intense the violence was, especially in Belfast, but in other parts of the island. We, you know, in this period. I think that it really hits home. So I think it's worth mentioning.
That's correct. And I think what's also interesting, and Kieran ends the piece with this, is an example of D.I. Nixon as someone who has been suspected for many decades as someone who was orchestrating these attacks, because there were many more attacks on Catholics during this period by suspected B-specials. For example, and I think it's one of the most resonant issues of the day because there was not a prosecution in this case. As we know, when the Emergency Powers Act was passed in 1922, this gave the Northern Ireland government basically an opportunity not to prosecute this to the letter of the law. The coroner's verdict was inconclusive, rather, as to who were the perpetrators. It should be noted, nonetheless, that even the Unionist press in Belfast were, there was an outcry within, the Belfast Telegraph, for example, that this was an example of murder most foul. So I think it's an issue which still resonates to this day. And I suppose you could make the case that, in the later troubles, of course, there are victims' families there who, again, are still seeking justice. So there are kind of resonances from this earlier period. And, of course, there are families from the later troubles who also suffered during this early 20th century period of violence. So I think we need to look at Northern Ireland both as part of the Irish Revolution, but also as its own significant history. And as you said, Kieran dealt with it in fine detail, but also great care and sympathy.
Thanks, Dara. And before we kind of round things off, can you tell our viewers, give us a sense of who else is in there and what they can look out for?
So this is a multi-contributor volume. We have over 20 contributors dealing, like I said, from the period from truce to treaty, a section on treaty to civil war, the civil war itself, and then an epilogue. And I think you quite rightly noted Brian Hanley, my co-editor's piece. Brian looks at the end of civil war politics as a question. And I think that's a legitimate question by which to end the special issue of History Ireland's supplement. Again, it's important to recognise that this special issue doesn't gloss over the violence of the period. So John Dorney does an excellent job, for example, in literally accounting for the number of people who were killed by both the anti-treaty IRA and the Irish Free State. So it's important to recognise that there are protagonists on both sides who affected political violence. Another excellent essay which should be borne in mind is Kira Chambers' essay on cinema as history and history as cinema. So she looks at the films Michael Collins and The Wind That Shakes the Barley. And I think that's especially important, especially for our younger audience who very often are influenced by the powerful media of the film, of Hollywood and films more broadly. And one of the issues which connects Margaret O'Callaghan's essay on partition and Keira Chambers' essay is the extent to which the film Michael Collins, directed by Neil Jordan and released in 1996, established erroneously that the Anglo-Irish Treaty created partition. And both Margaret and Keira tried to negotiate the difficulties of remembering partition. In Margaret's case, she argues that partition was a process dating back to the 19th century. So I think that's really important. The role of this special issue is to inform, but also to educate. And we very much hope that our readers read this with a critical eye as we move forward in this decade of centenaries.
Thanks very much, Dara. And before we leave, can you tell us a bit about your latest book that's coming out soon?
So my next book is going to be published with Cambridge University Press in 2022. It's entitled Conflict, Diaspora and Empire, Irish Nationalism in Great Britain, 1912 to 1922. And it looks at this entire decade, the decade that we're marking commemoratively 100 years ago, looking at Irish communities in London, Liverpool, Cardiff and Glasgow. One of the most famous examples, of course, was Michael Collins, who lived in London prior to the 1916 Rising, and really integrating again the Irish diaspora into that island story.
Dr. Darragh Gannon, thanks very much.
Thanks, Barry.